as quickly as you can, ladies and gentlemen. I know people have trains and planes and things to catch at the end of the day, and already one of the MEPs is going to have to leave us halfway through this session, so please take your seat as soon as you can. I feel like I should give a big lecture now, but I won't. Following on, I think, the video we're going to show to begin this last section and lead us into our MEP's debate, I think really follows on from the three real stories, which I hope were inspiring to you all. It's a kind of electronic version of that, I think. Generation Food's mission is therefore to amplify stories from around the world, which inspire people to learn, to connect, to innovate, and to change the world food system. And I hope you've heard at least some examples, concrete examples of that happening very successfully from this stage today. So they're creating, as I say, a transmedia project, telling the stories across the globe which inspire and challenge and create what must happen, which is change. Have a look at this video.
So man, when you are near Ganga, you can Moguti nyoza nyoza, kwen sanga. Many moguti kadipira.
Mbuto hii ni za son, ni ila mkapuka kwa imesha. Kweni mbuto hii ni ya uyu ya sono, ita mpokela sono hii.
Ya, isi tinga kwa ni isi kwa natu mwewe sanga watere kankari.
Na kuyoya utu wakasanga utu mundu lawa na pukwa, uchita chita, ukarakara uta. Mwana kazi, dangulake ni isi tiwa ufili wa imu.
Ubaliwe mi, ubaliwe mi, eti kumongani. Isamalawi, eti kumongani. Isamalawi, be upatanya, be sepa mwani, eti kumongani. Isamalawi, eti kumongani. Isamalawi, chiuta fantasi, satana kunyuma, eti kumongani. Isamalawi, eti kumongani. Isamalawi.
We are talking about climate change because it is affecting us very much. You here in America, what are you doing about climate change? How are you going to help us?
Well, I work at a power plant, a coal-fired power plant. It's pretty clean, really.
Climate change, it's not a topic of conversation. We see it more as a political agenda.
It doesn't feel like that's a day-to-day thing you think about when you're just trying to manage your farm.
But when you got
Makora chumi.
And she's saying it looks very, very nice.
April, no good.
Us, June, we didn't have rain. April, we didn't have rain. March, we didn't have rain. Up to today.
I don't really like climate change. I think people take it out of proportion.
Here, I don't know what we could change. We could go back to farming with horses.
Charu chukita vichi, charu chukusinda. So iyo parawali, wachari denga washibwana. Angurongo sorakale, kutichaguyamba, maru yao na muyariji. Ndikuti makuni yalimu, apo isi kutu makuni nkuni kulivichi. Patati maru nga wemi, vipanga soma nyoba mtengele mwene mwuramu.
Do you eat this? This is a whole bowl of clam chowder right here.
Kweni somaji nganandi. Kweni suguri nyumba za kutoa. Vilivose ni viwemi.
Kwa uditirime chakulia, mbwenu...
Hapa na mungoni laine. Iyo. Kweni wamanyenge kwa kuti Nyerere. Ndu tundu tuchoko jomene. Kweni tukuye hapa nana. icho nchi grasshopper chikuru. So kwa hiyo akuona suzi.
Thanks to Generation Food for that message, that manifesto, if you like. So, much of what's been said about migration, food, and sustainability has played into all sorts of areas that we've discussed today: NGOs, personal experiences, personal journeys, business, the BCFN, and so forth, and of course, institutions here at Brussels. So it's now time to take it straight into the political arena, and in particular this issue of migration, but migration in the context of sustainable food production and the issues that cause it. So coming up for you now, a rainbow of MEPs ranged across the political spectrum as you look at it, helpfully enough, vaguely from the left to the right, if everybody goes to the right places. We'll assemble them now, five MPs of differing parties to debate the contentious issue of migration and, as I stress, its links to food. Huge subject area, but we want to focus in, obviously, on the issue of food. So without more ado, let's assemble our panel. I think I'll come down here. I'm sort of in the way up there. First up, we have, from the German Green Party, Maria Heubuch. Maria, come on out. Round of applause, please. And Maria will be speaking in German, so you might need the headsets to facilitate with that. It's always fun. It always creates a bit of chaos. I'll let you get on with that whilst I do the introduction for Maria. Maria is spokeswoman on development issues for the Greens, focused on EU development strategy in Africa, and a strong advocate of biodiversity. I think I'm also right in saying she's been a dairy farmer for 20 years.
For nearly 40 years.
40 years?
Nearly.
Surely going to be better. So, I don't know how she finds the time, but that's the truth of it. Next up to her, let's welcome Maria Arena. Maria, come on out. Don't be shy. Maria Arena is, as many of you will know, Belgian MEP for the Socialist Group, daughter of Sicilian immigrants to Belgium, and has spoken out, as again you may well be aware, against trafficking and particularly violence against women in the migrant community. I should stress, at some point, Maria is going to give you an elegant wave and say goodbye and disappear, because she doesn't want to avoid the difficult questions, but she does have an engagement in Paris, so she'll be bidding us adieu at some point. But we're very glad to have her time that she can give with us today until then. Next up, please welcome Jasenko Selimovic. Jasenko, MEP. MEP for Sweden's Liberal Democrats, born in Sarajevo, and raised, of course, during the war there, and has spoken often in the European Parliament on migration issues. So a warm welcome to you, Jasenko. I was in Sarajevo a lot during the war, so it's better days now, I hope. Next up, please give a very warm welcome to Fabio Castaldo. Fabio. Hello. Fabio is, of course, MEP and Vice President of the European Parliament, representing Italy's Europe of Freedom and Direct Democracy group. Also, incidentally, works on the EU's 44 billion euro fund for sustainable development and investment plan to tackle mass migration. And your final MEP for your delectation, Sofia Ribeiro. Sofia, welcome. Well, there we are, Sofia. You've already got, I think, two cheers just for coming on stage. So, Portuguese MEP for the EPP group representing the Azores. She's led the group in the Agriculture Committee and on the new Alliance for Food Security and Nutrition Resolution. So give them all a round of applause. Welcome, everybody. Now, what we're going to do, they're going to make a short... We'll pretend this is an election campaign. There is an election campaign coming up fairly soon, isn't there? So treat this as... not too far away. Treat this as a rehearsal, okay? So it's a free rehearsal laid on by the Barilla Forum. So aren't they wonderful people? I'm going to ask each in turn, starting with Maria, for no particular reason, but that's the order they came on, to do a quick three-minute speech on the subject of addressing how should the EU help to address the environmental and food-related root causes of migration now and going forward. We know it's partly caused by war, but we know by now, I think, that it's also caused by longer-term underlying factors of food and sustainability. And that's what we're here to address. So, Maria.
I will start. Herzlichen Dank für die Einladung heute, dass ich hier sprechen darf. Ich glaube, wir sprechen hier über eine völlig paradoxe Situation. Weltweit werden auf der einen Seite genügend Nahrungsmittel produziert, auf der anderen Seite reden wir über Lebensmittelverschwendung. 30% ungefähr wird bei uns in Europa weggeschmissen. Auf der einen Seite wurde 2016 zum ersten Mal wieder die Zahl der Hungernden ist die Zahl der Hungernden angestiegen. Also der Hunger nimmt zu und wir haben mehr Nahrungsmittel oder ausreichend Nahrungsmittelproduktion. Heute Abend werden circa jeder achte Mensch hungrig ins Bett gehen. Es ist auch paradox, wenn wir auf Europäischer Union Abkommen unterzeichnen für eine nachhaltige Entwicklung, wie die SDGs oder wie das Klimaabkommen von Paris. Das spiegelt sich dann aber auf der anderen Seite nicht wieder in unserem mehrjährigen Finanzrahmen. Klimawandel ist unbestritten auch eine Fluchtursache und wurde nicht Priorität in unserem Haushalt. Also wo bleibt hier eigentlich konsequentes Handeln? Weil das würde bedeuten, dass wir hier in Europa auch unsere Hausaufgaben machen müssen. Wir beklagen in Europa eine Flüchtlingskrise, aber 9 von 10 Flüchtlingen kommen nicht bei uns an, sondern meist in den armen Nachbarländern oder in Schwellenländern. Allein Uganda hat 1,5 Millionen Menschen Flüchtlinge aufgenommen. Also Menschen, die Hunger leiden, die Krieg, Gewalt ausgesetzt sind, Menschen, die wegen Dürre oder Flut ihre Felder und damit ihre Existenzgrundlage verlieren, die machen sich nun mal auf den Weg. Das wird zur Überlebensstrategie. Und wenn wir also ernährungsbezogene Fluchtursachen bekämpfen wollen, dann müssen wir viel mehr tun, um Krisenherde einzudämmen. Wir müssen mehr tun, um Frieden und Stabilität zu fördern. Doch warum leitet die Europäische Union ihre Gelder um? Weg von Friedensarbeit und hin zu mehr Militär, weg von Friedensarbeit hin zu mehr Grenzschutz. Menschen vor Ort, die brauchen Perspektiven, aber keine Zäune. Und dazu muss der mehrjährige Finanzrahmen langfristige Entwicklungszusammenarbeit zum Schwerpunkt machen. 75% der Menschen, die hungern, leben auf dem Land, sind Bäuerinnen und Bauern. Und hier braucht es ganz gezielte Investitionen in die Landwirtschaft. Agrarökologie bietet hier eine ganz hervorragende Chance. Sie baut Bodenfruchtbarkeit und Widerstandskraft auf. Sie schützt Klima und Umwelt und schafft vielfältige Arbeitsplätze vor Ort. Sie ist eine Investition in die Bäuerinnen und Bauern. Und die sind nun mal das Rückgrat der Landwirtschaft, ganz besonders im globalen Süden. Und das Thema Flucht und Migration wird uns im Wahlkampf beschäftigen. Das wird missbraucht werden von den Populisten und von den Nationalisten. Und hier müssen wir verantwortungsvolle Konzepte dagegen setzen. Konzepte mit den Menschen und für die Menschen vor Ort. Die Agrarindustrie hat keine befriedigenden Lösungen geboten in der Vergangenheit. Und sie versucht, Agrarökologie in einer Nische klein zu halten. Doch genau dadurch verschleudern wir ein riesiges Potenzial, ein Potenzial, das wir für die Zukunft brauchen.
Vielen Dank, Maria. Almost 21, 21, very good. So, Maria, the challenge is on. You have to be less than 21 seconds over, okay? Maria Arena from Belgium. Away you go.
Thank you. Merci beaucoup. Je vais parler en français, donc si les gens ont besoin d'écouteurs.
Ça va? Bien.
OK. Alors, moi, je pense que par rapport à la question du changement climatique, de la migration et de la souveraineté alimentaire, il y a beaucoup de choses à faire et que parfois en Europe, on est dans l'absence de cohérence. Alors, on est en Europe et dans le monde occidental, les principaux responsables des changements et des variations climatiques aujourd'hui, de par notre extrême consommation et de par notre modèle ultra-productiviste. C'est une réalité, c'est quelque chose qui est venu après-guerre et c'est quelque chose qu'on a construit dans le modèle occidental actuellement. Ce modèle-là, il pose des difficultés sur un plan environnemental, mais il ne le pose pas tellement en Europe. Si on a des changements climatiques, c'est peut-être un peu en Belgique, et on est souvent content d'avoir un peu plus de chaleur et un peu plus de soleil en Belgique. Mais par contre, les changements climatiques dans les pays du Sud sont catastrophiques, et on voit des flux de population liés à ces changements climatiques. Ça veut dire que nous devons changer une partie de notre modèle pour avoir un impact positif dans les pays qui sont les victimes de ce changement climatique. Deuxièmement, ces pays sont des pays qui sont en retard de développement et qui ont perdu une partie de leur souveraineté alimentaire et vers lesquels on a tendance à imposer notre modèle, alors qu'on sait que ce modèle est déjà difficile à soutenir sur la planète. Et donc on voit, et je reviens par exemple de Colombie, où il y a un modèle de production aujourd'hui qui va vers la concentration dans des multinationales très très fortes et qui irait vers de la monoculture en Colombie en détruisant les productions qui sont les productions de paysans locaux. Et donc quand on voit tout ça, on s'est dit mais quelle est notre cohérence? Alors il faut savoir qu'on peut changer les choses par une action. Vous m'avez présenté comme étant quelqu'un qui lutte contre le trafic des êtres humains et particulièrement des femmes, mais je travaille aussi dans une commission au Parlement européen, qui est la commission commerce international. Et dans cette commission, on fait des accords de libre-échange. Eh bien, aujourd'hui, j'ai le regret de dire que ces accords de libre-échange ne remettent pas en question les modèles qui, aujourd'hui, sont des modèles destructeurs de bien-être. Et moi, ce que je demande, tout simplement, et je vais en terminer avec ça et j'aurai pris mon temps, c'est que ces accords de libre-échange, d'accord, à la seule condition, c'est qu'ils aient un chapitre développement durable, c'est-à-dire qu'ils respectent l'environnement et le droit des populations à pouvoir décider de leur souveraineté alimentaire. Et ce n'est qu'à ce titre-là que le commerce sera bénéfique pour tout le monde.
Merci. Merci, Marie. Thank you very much on that. You can have another 4 seconds if you like. Jasenko. Jasenko Selimovic, of course, from the ALDE party in Sweden. Your 3 minutes starts now.
Thank you very much. I'll not try to speak in Swedish or Bosnian. your chances are much less than that. I do agree with the certain points that has been brought up by my colleagues, but I'll start from the other point of view in order to bring some other perspective. In 2050, the Earth will have 10 billion inhabitants. And just to say it very clearly, everybody, more or less everybody sitting in this room will experience it. It's just in 30 years, we'll be 10 billions, meaning that we have to produce kind of 50 up to 70% more food than we are producing today. And at the same time, the land available for the production of the food is shrinking. It's actually shrinking already today. So in order to solve that equation, you need to produce more on a smaller piece of land. And if you put that in a frame of the poverty, in a frame of conflicts, in a frame of food insecurity that we are talking about, then you realize we have to do something radically here. And I don't know, actually, realistically speaking, I don't know how to solve that equation. But I know that we are not speaking about it. When you talk about climate change, well, whether you like the propositions that we have, whether you don't like it, okay, we are doing something on it. Nobody can say we are forgetting climate change. If you talk about food production, food insecurity, the frame of the work that we are supposed to do in the next 30 years, we are not coming with any proposal. And key is, in my view as a liberal, key is innovation. We have to have a new ways of producing food, including these controversial ones, plant breeding, you know, that we are not even speaking about today. We have new ways of collaborating with the companies. We have new ways of organization. We have a solution that are on a local, municipality, regional, European level. We need to combine all that, and still we are not there. We haven't solved the problem. So how to solve it? Yeah, well, we'll have to speak a little bit more than that today. But I'm certain that there is something to speak about. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yes, thank you. Well, now this is a political debate, and I am not biased. So I'm starting on the left and going over a little bit to the right to sort of show a bit of balance to everybody. Fabio Castaldo from the EFDD in Italy. You have 3 minutes.
Thank you very much. 26 milioni sono ogni anno I profughi causati dai disastri naturali. 200 milioni sono I migranti che si prevedono entro il 2050 per ragioni ambientali. Intere aree del pianeta non sono più abitabili per la crescente desertificazione. Le siccità creano crisi alimentari che costringono intere popolazioni locali a migrare alla ricerca di nuovi mezzi di sostentamento. A questo quadro si aggiungono anche le tempeste di sabbia, un fenomeno sempre più crescente che sta erodendo le risorse idriche nel Medio Oriente. Questo del cambiamento climatico non è qualcosa di intangibile, è una prospettiva di un futuro lontano. È sotto I nostri occhi ed è sotto I nostri occhi adesso. Per questo, a mio personale parere, è il momento, come Unione Europea, di fare un passo in avanti. Dobbiamo assumere una leadership ambiziosa a livello globale, andando ben oltre gli accordi di Parigi e l'agenda del 2030. Gli Stati membri devono dare l'esempio. Allineare le politiche nazionali, raggiungere quegli obiettivi previsti nella strategia coordinata a lungo termine per il 2050. E il sostegno che dobbiamo darlo soprattutto anche ai paesi in via di sviluppo, con un piano di investimenti ambizioso che punti anche a un processo di transizione verso un modello economico solidale ed ecosostenibile. Dobbiamo abbandonare quella miope politica dell'emergenza del border management e affrontare le cause profonde della migrazione. Il Trust Fund for Migration, che è stato utilizzato come strumento finora teoricamente prioritario, in realtà sta parzialmente fallendo il suo obiettivo, visto che l'utilizzo in maniera flessibile e rapida per l'emergenza migratoria lo sta in realtà allontanando, portandolo quasi a essere un tampone al posto di essere quello strumento peculiare che doveva creare un sostegno a lungo termine. Noi dobbiamo evitare che questi strumenti diventino un vulnus, dobbiamo avere una politica coerente per lo sviluppo che ponga la lotta contro la povertà e la tutela dell'ambiente prioritaria rispetto agli interessi delle imprese multinazionali e aiutare le popolazioni locali con un modello che sia capito e voluto dalle popolazioni stesse. Su questo dobbiamo costruire il nostro bilancio pluriennale per I prossimi 7 anni, partendo anche dagli famosi goals, the Sustainable Development Goals delle Nazioni Unite. E la chiave per rafforzare questo dialogo deve essere parlare direttamente con le popolazioni, deve essere spingere affinché i governi siano a loro volta messi sotto pressione da un nostro rapporto diretto con le popolazioni con cui dobbiamo interloquire, partendo principalmente dai giovani. La nostra politica di cooperazione e sviluppo deve partire anche da programmi di mobilità circolare, una mobilità che non deve privare I paesi del sud del Mediterraneo e dell'Africa subsahariana dei loro migliori talenti e devono operare nel territorio, ma ritornare consapevolmente alla propria terra di origine con formazione e con esperienza per portare lì un arricchimento e quelle competenze, lì dove servono. La nostra politica di cooperazione e sviluppo è e sarà lo specchio dei nostri valori e lo specchio della nostra anima. A noi decidere con I fatti che tipo di immagine vogliamo che sia riflessa. Grazie.
Grazie Fabio, grazie mille. And finally Sofia Ribeiro, EPP Portugal, the Azores in fact.
Yeah.
You have your 3 minutes.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank the organization for inviting me for this important debate. And I will start by saying that sometimes we don't have in mind the important role that the European Union plays in the entire world what concerns global health. We're just representing 7% of the world's population, but the European Union represents 50% of the global aid to what concerns developing countries. And just in 2017, we provided 75.7 billion euros of help. The EU, together with its member countries, supported the adaptation programs and projects towards climate change, providing 14.5 billion in 2014. And we want to double this by 2020. We also have provided 2 billion years grants to developing countries. We need also to pay attention, and contrary to what Maria Arana said, complimenting her, free trade agreements can play here a major role. We have to consider also the free trade agreements that we are negotiating with the developing countries, and which are providing them more resources so that they can also be aware and integrate the common market. We have also, and I need to talk about the new allies for food, which I was the EPP responsible in the European Parliament. And our main goal was to protect people in the developing countries. So we try to put this important program at the service of the population. We cannot look at these developing countries as if they were the barns of the European Union. So we stated that people should, these local communities should have the opportunities to stay in their lands, to cultivate their lands, to take food out, and to create the better conditions to all. We also said that we should help them to, in order so that they could preserve their soils and a good management of water. And we believe that we can also doing this, only acting at the origin is that the only way to prevent these migration fluxes. The EPP thinks that the immigrants should come to Europe by a conscious decision, not led by despair, by lack of food. So for the EPP defends that in first we should separate the migrants from the refugees in order to be aware of the different needs that this population has. We need definitely an European approach, a good integration system with the participation of all member states, and of course not jeopardizing the European security of our borders. And for now, that's all.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Sophia. Well, now, my question that arises is this. Some years ago in the EU, there was clearly a migrant crisis. And a lot of people, I think, in the EU, a lot of people around the world, would look at the response and conclude there was no EU response. The EU didn't exist. Faced with this crisis, my fence is bigger than your fence. Germany didn't have a fence, and then thought, oh, we've made a mistake, you know. It was, I think by common consent, it was a mess. So thinking about that experience and projecting it now and thinking about the issues that we're talking about here, food sustainability, putting a stop to this kind of migration before it starts, and I know war is a big factor here. What has changed since that crisis? What do we need to make the EU more coherent about this and more resilient to it?
Respect countries.
Respect countries, okay.
Construire des murs, c'est ce qu'il y a de plus facile et c'est ce qu'il y a de plus inefficace. Parce que quand vous mourrez de faim, c'est pas un mur qui va vous empêcher de passer. Moi, je suis fille d'immigrés. Mes parents ont quitté le sud de l'Italie après la Seconde Guerre mondiale parce qu'ils crevaient de faim. Et ils auraient été prêts à mourir pour quitter l'endroit dans lequel ils étaient qui leur donnait aucun espoir. Et il y aurait pu y avoir des murs, ils auraient franchi les murs. Il y aurait pu y avoir des mers, ils auraient franchi les mers. Et donc, ce n'est pas la solution. Je ne suis pas du tout d'accord avec ma collègue du PPE quand elle dit « les accords commerciaux, c'est la solution ». Bien sûr, le commerce est une solution. Et je suis d'accord de dire que le commerce nous a aidés, bien sûr. Mais aujourd'hui, le commerce tel qu'on le fait, quand vous allez au Kenya et que les terres fertiles du Kenya sont utilisées avec des pesticides agressifs pour planter des bananes et des haricots prêts à l'exportation et pour retirer les terres aux paysans
qui sont sur place et qui n'arrivent plus à se nourrir parce que les eaux sont polluées, eh bien ça, ça ne permet pas aux Kenyans de s'en sortir. Quand vous avez des exploitations d'or qui sont traitées au mercure et qui arrivent dans les nappes phréatiques et qui ne permettent plus aux paysans d'utiliser leur eau, eh bien ça ne marche pas. Et donc je dis à l'Europe que si la solution qu'elle apporte, c'est des murs, eh bien l'Europe périra. Elle périra tout simplement. Si l'Europe veut survivre, elle doit investir et elle doit être responsable. Et elle doit demander à ses entreprises qu'elle a aujourd'hui en Europe, que ces entreprises soient responsables quand elles plantent, quand elles ont des terres et quand elles utilisent des paysans. Ça, c'est être cohérent. Mais aujourd'hui, si vous prenez le groupe ALDE, le groupe PPE, les Cinque Stelle, j'en sais rien parce que le EFDD, on ne sait pas ce qu'il fait. Mais je veux dire, ce sont des groupes. Désolé, je vais pas. Ce sont des groupes. Ils vont pouvoir dire tout le mal qu'ils pensent de moi. Donc je vais m'en aller. Mais ce sont des groupes qui aujourd'hui disent la main sur le cœur. Nous voulons sauver les pauvres, mais qui en réalité ne prennent pas les responsabilités et les décisions qui sont nécessaires pour le faire. J'ai tendance à dire clairement les choses. Ils me connaissent tous au Parlement européen pour dire les choses clairement. On n'est pas d'accord, mais je pense que la politique, c'est aussi ça, c'est d'exprimer des sujets sur lesquels on n'est pas d'accord et essayer de convaincre, vous convaincre, parce que c'est vous qui votez. C'est vous qui votez pour moi, c'est vous qui votez pour eux, et c'est parce que vous votez pour des gens qui défendent un idéal qui n'est pas le même que cet idéal est promu au niveau international. Je suis désolée, mais je vais leur laisser la possibilité de me taper dessus comme ils veulent, puisqu'en plus, je ne suis pas là. Et donc, voilà. Désolée. Merci beaucoup.
Désolée, merci. Bon voyage. Merci. Merci beaucoup, Marie. Marie, just please move up. Well, I think Maria used her brief time here very effectively, if I may say so. Let's have more ideas. How do we make Europe more resilient, more strong in the face of these crises? Because food and sustainability, Marie, is a long-term course. There's no question about that.
Genau. Wir brauchen hier eine Langfristigkeit in den Planungen, aber auch in den Programmen, die wir auflegen. Auf der einen Seite, wir brauchen aber auch eine Kohärenz in allen Politikfeldern. Castaldo hat es angesprochen. Wenn wir mit der Handelspolitik auf der einen Seite das kaputt machen, was wir auf der anderen Seite mit einem tollen entwicklungspolitischen Programm aufbauen, wird es uns nicht weiterhelfen. Wir müssen hier wirklich auf Augenhöhe kommen, auch mit den Akteuren vor Ort. Es ist nicht so, es ist einfach zu sagen, ja, wir werden sie mit einbinden. Nein, es geht nicht um Einbinden, es geht um Augenhöhe. Wenn in diesen Ländern die Menschen nicht zu Rohstofflieferanten degradiert werden sollen, dann heißt es im Umkehrschluss, dort wird Produktion stattfinden. Und wenn ich an Kaffee denke, dann wird der geröstet, der wird nur einmal geröstet. Und wenn er direkt in Burundi geröstet wird, dann wird er bei uns nicht mehr geröstet. Und das müssen wir mal klar und offen auf den Tisch legen. Also wo findet dieses Geben und Nehmen statt, damit wir hier auf mehr Balance kriegen und auf Augenhöhe kommen. Denn es ist in der Tat so, wie Maria Arena gesagt hat, wenn die Menschen keine Perspektive haben, machen sie sich auf den Weg. Gucken wir in der Geschichte zurück, das haben wir Europäerinnen und Europäer auch gemacht. Deshalb haben wir die Communities überall auf der Welt. Also hier müssen wir wirklich richtig kohärent sein. Genau genommen müssen wir alle Politikfelder genau durchleuchten, wo entsprechen wir den Nachhaltigkeitszielen bei uns und in dem, was wir extern machen und wo sind wir kohärent, wo tangiert es eigentlich all diese Ziele in der Handelspolitik, in der Wirtschaftspolitik, in der Finanzpolitik, in der Steuerpolitik und natürlich in der Agrarpolitik. Und zwar bei uns jetzt steht ja eine Agrarreform an, genauso wie das, was wir in unseren Förderprogrammen in anderen Regionen dieser Welt machen.
Thank you very much. I want to open it out to questions in a moment. I know we've got some questions from NGOs, but from our other three MEPs, I'd like a response to another question, which will be occurring in the minds of many. It's very easy with a question like migration that we talk about the EU. But it is obvious that there is a division, a cultural division perhaps, within the EU, in the east of Europe and in the west of Europe. Let's face it, broadly speaking, generalization, there are different views, shall we say, about the issue of migration. Jasenko, how do we approach that? Fabio, you were nodding as well. That is a problem for the EU, isn't it? This coherence issue.
Well, you posed a very direct question. I think it demands the direct answer. We don't have any answers on this, and unfortunately, this is the reality. We didn't have it. We didn't learn anything about the former crisis that we had. I was one of these refugees in the 90s, fleeing the war in former Yugoslavia, ending up in Sweden by different reasons. And somebody said, well, now we learn what the refugee crisis should, how we should manage it. We didn't learn anything about it. We just repeated it 10 years later with the Syrian and Iraqis and people coming from Africa.
Really, the EU learned nothing?
Well, more or less nothing. We have a cultural divide, as you said. We didn't learn how to cope with the problems of the food insecurity. All the people that fled me fled from some kind of garden. Somebody was farming the land. You know, first, they cannot get back the land because the laws are not there in place to them. The war was ethnically cleansing the territorium in order to not to have any longer your land. Yeah. So they cannot get back to that land. That land is actually kind of destroyed now. Nobody is working on it. We just is kind of getting nowhere with that. These people are not wanting to get back because they survived something that they don't want to go back to. In Western Europe, we didn't find a common answer to these questions. We see that today we cannot agree on Dublin. We cannot agree on common answer. We didn't agree how to produce the food, even if we are losing some sources of the food outside. In Western Balkans, we haven't learned how to produce by ourselves. We have laws that our companies are fleeing Europe. You know, the best developed companies that are producing food and have a lot of research and innovation are in, believe me, China or states.
Right.
China is actually running a ways ahead of us, and our companies are going either to states or to China. So no, we don't have an answer. We don't have the unfortunately. Well, we cannot come to the point.
Of course. Well, that's a very straight answer to a straight question. Fabio, Sofia, can you help Jasenko out? I mean, that's a pretty damning indictment. The EU learned nothing from these crises back in the 90s.
Beh, in primis, mi dispiace che Maria Elena sia già partita, le avrei risposto molto volentieri in francese, che forse ha la memoria corta, perché nel corso di questi anni tantissimi dossier, sia a carattere molto forte, sia ambientale che sociale, sono passati con i voti decisivi del Movimento 5 Stelle al Parlamento Europeo. Mi pare strano che abbia avuto un'amnesia momentanea, ma forse si è sempre in campagna elettorale permanente. Tolto questo, per rispondere alla domanda che mi è stata posta, in questo momento siamo davanti al Consiglio forse più diviso di sempre. C'è una divisione nord-sud per quanto riguarda i destini economici dell'Unione Europea, c'è una divisione est-ovest per quanto riguarda la stessa idea di integrazione europea. E questo si riflette ovviamente anche nell'atteggiamento un po' sclerotico che abbiamo agli occhi del mondo esterno. E questo lo dico perché non è capitato infrequentemente che la posizione ufficiale esternata dall'alto rappresentante Mogherini fosse magari smentita dalle manovre dietro di fatti di tanti stati membri in competizione tra loro. Noi dobbiamo capire una cosa molto importante: questo è un momento di transizione incredibile nel quale, come diceva Jasenko prima di me, soffriamo la concorrenza dei due modelli, quello muscolare e unilaterale dei nuovi Stati Uniti, da un lato, e quello invece estremamente aggressivo della Cina, dall'altro. Dov'è che noi possiamo fare la differenza? Non, certamente non inseguendo quei tipi di modelli nei nostri accordi di commerciali, che non vanno accantonati, ma vanno ripensati nel loro contenuto, e proponendoci fortemente come un partner che pensa allo sviluppo a lungo termine di quelle popolazioni. Noi finora abbiamo fallito nell'approccio alle migrazioni perché non abbiamo pensato ad affrontare le cause, ma solo a come mettere un tampone e una toppa alle conseguenze. E se noi non capiamo che è necessario adesso mobilizzare un numero di fondi adeguato per costruire, puntare lì a creare accesso all'energia elettrica, magari anche con l'off-grid, quindi con soluzioni che non siano invasive ma siano più puntuali, se non pensiamo a creare lì veramente uno sviluppo partendo anche dal sostegno alle piccole e medie imprese, al commercio locale, all'agricoltura tradizionale, molto presto ci troveremo davanti a un fenomeno decuplicato o anche centuplicato. Il trend demografico in Africa è molto chiaro, sta a noi assumere questa responsabilità se vogliamo essere coerenti con quel Nobel della pace che abbiamo vinto qualche anno fa. fa.
Right. Grazie. It's a multi-layered problem. Sofia, can you offer any more reassurance?
Yes, of course.
These people need it, you know?
Yes, of course. On this issue, first of all, of course, that we have a separation to what concerns, a split to what concerns the Council. And that's why the European Parliament, as a co-decision institution, has so many relevance. So every citizen on the next elections has to be aware of the power of the European Parliament and pose those questions to the candidates, to MEPs, in order to find out who is providing the correct, the proper answers. Because we can't just address things superficially with the populist ideals without providing concrete answers, and that's the question. When you're talking about separation of and the frontiers, the social frontiers and the economic frontiers, what do we want? Do you want to close the social frontiers and close the economic frontiers? Do we want to maintain the frontiers close to people and open them to the markets, to the goods? Or what do we want to have open frontiers but regulated frontiers? That's the question. That's the main issue. We need to have, when you're talking about free trade agreements, Europe is shifting from the free trade, which is common said, to global trade and investment agreements, so that we can then pose the responsibility also in our partners, so that they can reassure that they are providing the main issues, the main concerns to what concerns human rights, for instance.
Sure.
So we are shifting the way that we are facing the entire world. And we should also not just address the question to what we are we going to do now that we have inflow of migrants. We need also to address the question at the root, at the cause of the problem.
Of course,
the cause of the problem is to help those developing countries. And we have several, as I said in the beginning, we have several projects to do that. And we have already launched together with the International Organization for Migration, through the Emergency Trust Fund for Africa, a major plan to strengthen migration governance and to respond to the needs of the local people.
Right.
So that's just an example on
sure.
what we are doing globally and what do we need to do on the future in order to address this
sure.
issue.
But action is being taken, difficult questions and difficult decisions to be taken about borders. Happily, you mentioned the IOM. They're going to be asking a question in just a moment or two. So we've got a number of NGOs, I think, who've already got, I hope, questions to ask our panelists here. And the first is indeed from the IOM, International Organization for Migration. So their question is to be directed to Fabio. So Mr. or Mrs. IOM person, are you in the room with your question? Yes, sir. Say hello. Tell us who you are. Should just work. That's it.
Yep.
Good.
Good afternoon, everyone. Patrice Quesada. I'm working for the International Organization for Migration, which is not an NGO. And I have the first question for you that should have been on the screen or that I have in my pocket, because it's a very easy one, but a very long one for Fabio. Yes, here we
are. There it is.
You can look.
You made also some comments about linking the North and the South, so this question is about foreign policy.
Fabio.
So if you look at the relationship between climate and demographic changes, what, in your view, are some of the main dimensions or the main impact of it that the EU, through its external policy, could anticipate, in particular, having in mind the EU global strategy for foreign and security policy? Thank you.
Thank you very much. From the IOM, which is not an NGO.
Yes.
That's me told.
In fact, it's an agency of the UN.
I'm not walking out, by the way. I'm just, you know, rebalancing. Nor am I going to threaten our dear friend from the IOM. See you later. Right. Fabio.
Thank you very much. It's a very interesting question,
yeah.
In fact. In my opinion, the demographic trends of Africa are clear. I met some of your colleagues in the last mission I have done in Tripoli, in Libya, the first mission that has been done by the European Parliament since 6 years in the countries. And it's clear that until now, the response of the different ways and the different unfortunately, routes of migration was inadequate. Was inadequate because we were trying just to enforce in some way kind of border management, border control, instead of starting this huge cooperation with the countries. But let's be honest and clear on that. We can put into reality what we decided in Paris, even if the states are decided to step out. It will not be enough. It will not be enough because this climate change, the dimension of the climate change, and these consequences in many countries are much more bigger than what we expected some years ago. But at the same time, we also realize that the demographic growth and trend in Africa can bring in the next 50 years to almost redouble the population we have nowadays. And on the contrary, what we have seen from many companies, not just from Chinese, unfortunately, as it was said before, is the phenomenon of land grabbing. The land grabbing is completely eroding the possibility for many communities to continue to have their tradition, their local agriculture, and they are, in some cases, totally excluded and put out from their ancestral community, ancestral land, without any kind of form of respects. How can we deliver a different model and an approach to the governments that are doing that at the local level? We cannot follow the Chinese on their ground, on their dimension, and on their vision of what are the foreign affairs. I'm still convinced that we should deliver with different projects, with different programs, focus at with a direct interaction between the EU and the population on the ground and the local communities. We must go there and speak with the local communities, the local tribes, all the communities that can bypass some kind of governments that are not interested in having transparent and accountable institutions, and they are much more easy, they fit much more comfortable to have other kinds of agreements that are clearly not respecting the rights of their population and the needs of their population. So this is the model I will try and we will try to defend, and I hope to be really close in the work that you are done on the ground. And it's, by the way, it's very excellent. I saw that with my eyes in Libya, and I would like to thank you very much for all the efforts and all the risk that your people is taking every day on the ground. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And I also rely on your press releases as well, so thank you. And thank you, Fabio, for raising the issue of land grabbing. Actually, that's a huge issue, scarcely mentioned here today, so very relevant to bring that into the debate. Thanks for that. Our next question comes from PICM, also known as the Platform for International Cooperation on Undocumented Migrants. And the question is to be directed to Sofia Ribeiro. So, welcome. Say hello. Tell us who you are.
My name is Rosemary from Den Boogaard, from PICM, and thank you very much for considering our question, which is, what will the European Union do to protect undocumented workers from wage theft and ensure European food production does not thrive on the exploitation of migrant workers?
Okay. Thank you.
Just a small issue. Two great questions. Thanks, guys.
Well, first of all, we need to monitor and inspect the farms and the agri-food industries, which are especially very close to our borders. And this is very important, the inspection of ways of work. We also need to address the questions of the food supply chain in order to guarantee fairness in the food supply chain. And we are now addressing these questions since after a very strong point of pressure from the European Parliament, now the European Commission has presented a proposal on a directive on the food supply chain. Other points that I defend, as I was, I had a report on the Agri Committee, one opinion on the working conditions and precarious employment. And in this sector, first of all, I need to recall that migrant workers are protected by a directive 2014/36. And this directive established the conditions of entry and stay of third country nationals for the purpose of employment and as seasonal workers, and established minimum standards and rights. And so in this report, I recall that. But I went further on. I said that we also request that by September 2019, we should have a progress report on this directive. I also defend that we should stare for this major value that for equal work, we need to have equal social protections. I stated and proposed that member states are obliged to organize information sessions to seasonal and migrant workers about their rights and always be available for support and help. We need also more targeted inspections and checks in these farms. And we also defended technical training in order to know how to work, in order to protect the exposure of these workers from work risks. To conclude, I will bet on inspections, targeted checks, training and information checks, sessions to the workers, a close work with the national authorities and in the countries of origin, and last but not least, a very strong work in the food supply chain in order to be more fair, so that we can have equal work, equal pay, equal protection.
Thank you very much, Sofia. And of course, we're not just talking about the exploitation of workers, we're actually talking, we may as well say the word, slavery, which is creeping back into this situation under the guise of the mass movement of people, which is quite an indictment in the 21st century, that slavery, we should even be using the word, that it's happening at all anywhere in the world, but particularly in Europe, in the EU. Now, our next question is from the Open Society Foundations. It's for Maria. They're not here today, I don't think, are they? Yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, 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 they're not. So I will therefore read their question, and again, a huge issue. The question is this, is the dumping of cheap European food products in emerging economies one of the food-related causes of migration? The dumping of cheap European food actually causing migration, Maria?
Man muss es vielleicht ein bisschen differenziert betrachten, aber in bestimmten Ländern und in bestimmten Sektoren kann man das wirklich mit einem Ja beantworten. Ich würde aber da weniger auf die Schwellenländer gucken. Wir reden heute von Hungerbekämpfung. Das geht einher mit Armutsbekämpfung und deshalb müssen wir auch auf die am wenigsten entwickelten Länder schauen. Und es gibt diese ganz klassischen Beispiele, die leider Gottes immer noch stimmen, wie die Milch in Westafrika. Wir haben Verbindungen nach Burkina Faso und dort ist es immer noch so, dass die Bäuerinnen, dort sind es vorwiegend die Frauen, unter den Exporten von unserem Milchpulver leiden. Wir haben das Beispiel der Hähnchen in Ghana und der Präsident Ghanas hat bei der Generalversammlung der Vereinten Nationen einen Zusammenhang hergestellt zwischen den Exporten von Geflügelfleisch und der Migration. Und er hat dort wirklich gesagt, Ghaner, die sich auf die riskante Reise nach Europa begeben, sind Geflügelzüchter oder Unternehmer, die ihre Geschäfte schließen, da sie nicht mehr mit den Tonnen an gefrorenen Hühnchen konkurrieren können, die jährlich auf den afrikanischen Markt geladen werden. Also es gibt diese Verbindungen tatsächlich noch und da dürfen wir uns eigentlich überhaupt nicht wegducken, sondern da müssen wir wirklich drauf schauen und wir können nicht so tun, als hätte die Art, wie wir Landwirtschaft in Europa betreiben, aber auch Landwirtschaftspolitik gestalten, keine Auswirkungen auf andere Regionen dieser Welt. Alles ist miteinander verlinkt. Wir haben die Handelsabkommen angesprochen, ist ein sehr großes Feld. Und da liegt eben die Verantwortung und das ist auch exakt der Punkt, was ich vorher gesagt habe. Wir müssen kohärent werden. Wir müssen die Politikfelder abklopfen. Wie sind die Auswirkungen in viele verschiedenen Richtungen und können nicht nur immer so mit einer Scheuklappe nur auf Handel gucken oder nur auf Landwirtschaft oder nur auf die Armutsbekämpfung, wenn wir es nicht endlich zusammendenken und einen gesamtheitlichen Ansatz hier finden, dann werden wir ewig auf der Stelle treten. Vielleicht sogar Rückschritte machen.
Yeah, vielleicht. Thank you very much. I think, yeah, I mean, we've talked about this east-west dimension in Europe. We've talked about the north-south dimension. I mean, the pictures that are emerging exactly from these questions is the complexity of the issues. The final question is to you, Jasenko. It's from the ECD PM, European Centre for Development Policy Management. Please, your question. There you are. Again, do say who you are. We're all very friendly.
Thank you very much. My name is Noemi Keskon. I'm a migration policy officer at the European Centre for Development Policy Management. So my question is goes to you, Mr. Selimovic. So it has been argued by NGOs and academic institute and the like that the European response to the root causes of migration, including food insecurity, has led to ownership issues in Africa, that it has been an agenda that is very much EU-driven and imposed on African actors, which are not given a voice and which are not consulted. So my question is to you is how the EU can learn from this, and how can the EU ensure that interventions targeting food insecurity can foster ownership at various level of the food value chain?
Thank you. Thank you very much for your question. I think, as I said earlier, I will repeat it, the first step on solving this issue, on solving every issue today in Europe, is admitting that we are in a mess. We haven't yet admitted it, so we will need some time to admit it, that we are not giving the adequate response to the problem we are, to the challenges we are facing. You're posing one of them, and certainly there are part of our policy has caused the problem, and part of our policies has solved the problem, because there is a different issues. But certainly cooperation with the organization of every level is needed in order to ensure the equivalence of the policies. Because sometimes in Sweden, where I'm coming from, you know, these policies, we used to believe that state will handle it in a good way. And then you suddenly understand that we are paying for the other states, and some of these states are actually led by culprits. You don't want to give them that money, certainly not in a state budget or whatever it is. You don't want to make a partnership with them. On the other hand, there are countries that are posing, like Italy, like other countries, they are actually trying to encourage the cooperation on the local level with the local organization. And that's as well good, but suddenly you understand some of these people are culprits as well, you know. The locals are not good just because they're locals. They might be as well kind of difficult people to deal with. So I think these kind of cooperation with the institution on the different levels, giving aid on the different levels, making a cooperation on the different levels, making joint companies, will lead us to solve these issues that you are talking about. This is one of the issues when you are in a mess, is try to see around you what is happening, how the others are solving, and teaching ourselves how the others are solving will be a good first step. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And of course, you get this wrong, and within seconds, you are into allegations of what looks like neocolonialism,
frankly,
no matter what intentions you set out with. Thank you very much. Now, they say in some quarters that the EU is not a democratic institution. We're going to prove that wrong, because these four good people, and I'm sure Maria Arena would be a fifth if she could be here, are going to make a one-minute final upsum statement of, well, I've left it open, really, your final thoughts on the EU and this issue of migration and the issue of food and sustainability. So your final 1 minute. It's also very unfair, because somebody has to go first, somebody has to go last, but we'll do it the opposite way around to the initial introductory remarks. And at the end of the 1 minute, cards at the ready, you get to do the green and the red thing, okay? Well, show some excitement. Come on, guys. Well, yeah, a little woo would be nice. Thank you. This is democracy in the heart of Brussels, you know? This is what the British think doesn't exist. I'm proving them wrong, single-handedly. Right. On that note, that's my contract gone. Sofia, would you start, please? Give us a minute from Portugal on your summary thoughts on this issue. It's a huge issue, so 1 minute, if you would.
Well, I would bet on food security and food sovereignty. And we should not produce more, we should produce better. And we haven't talked here about the food waste, which is a very important subject. That's why I'm saying that we don't want to produce more, but better. And in order to do this, we need to provide farmers the proper conditions so that the European farmers, so that they can produce better. And so I'm very concerned to what is the European Commission proposal towards the next MFF, and we need to address this in a very strong manner. We don't want to feed the developing country. We want to help the developing countries with providing them answers facing and combating the root causes of the problem. So that's the head that European Union has to do. They need to provide them the tools so that they can be autonomous. And that's my ambition to the world.
Thank you. To the second. Magnificent. Now, give a card if you approve what Sophia has just said. It's a green. If you disapprove, it's a red.
Yay.
I'm searching for the reds. There must be one out there. Yes. One up there, one down here, overwhelmingly carried. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Thank you, Sophia. Give her a round of applause.
Thank you.
So, guess who's next, Fabio? Your minute starts now.
Grazie mille. 18.000 sono i migranti che sono morti negli ultimi tre anni. Fame, guerra e cambiamento climatico. Bene, io voglio dirvi una cosa. Se vogliamo veramente fare la differenza, dobbiamo uscire fuori da quella brutta malattia di cui per anni è stata affetta anche tanto la politica italiana, che si chiama annuncite, cioè la malattia degli annunci e degli slogan. Io vorrei che questo momento particolare, questo momento in cui si possono riscrivere anche il nostro ruolo e le nostre posizioni come Unione Europea, come Parlamento Europeo, possa essere utilizzato per diventare coerenti rispetto ai valori che difendiamo, coerenti proponendo lo sviluppo sostenibile a partire dal nostro bilancio, a partire dalla nostra agricoltura, a partire da tutti gli strumenti che abbiamo a disposizione. Questo è quello che dobbiamo pretendere, questo è quello che dobbiamo chiedere, soprattutto se vogliamo dare e essere un modello per i nostri partner, se vogliamo essere quel punto di riferimento che altri paesi hanno scelto di non essere esattamente in questi stessi mesi, in questi stessi anni. Dobbiamo essere coerenti con il cambiamento che vogliamo vedere nel mondo, coerenti con il cambiamento che questa Unione Europea può e deve meritare se vuole essere veramente il Nobel della pace che abbiamo conseguito qualche anno fa. Grazie.
Grazie mille, Fabio. So, cards at the ready, reds or greens? I think, oh, it's tricky. What do you think, Fabio? It's very difficult. I think
half.
I think it's 50-50. Yeah, 50-50. Grazie, Fabio. We move on. Jasenko.
And an applause.
Sweden, the Liberal Democrat view. Sum it up for us in. Sum it up for us in 1 minute.
Yes, thank you. What I believe is actually, if I start from the big picture, what has happened? I think that when Berlin Wall fall down, we believe we won. You know, European society believe we have solved all the problems. Freedom is here, let's go. And then we suddenly realize 20 or 30 years later, we don't know where to go. We don't have a plan. We don't have an idea where we are going, where we are heading. There is enormous challenges. This is one of them. Food security, migration, production of food, and we have to find a way of, first, innovating better, producing more food to give the population that is rising. Second, creating laws that are actually making it possible, both in Europe and the neighboring countries. Three, making it for the neighboring country possible to have a cooperation that is not colonial, that is actually kind of cooperation between us and them, giving win-win situation to both of them. And fourth, doing it in the frame of climate change. This is the task that are ahead of us. We should have started yesterday. Okay, let's start today. This is what I can do. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jasenko. And if you're Bosnian, you don't need any lessons about how quickly things can fall apart in Europe, right? So, greens and reds for Jasenko. It looks pretty green to me. Yep, overwhelmingly green. We move on. It's not scientific, it's just a bit of amusement. We move on. Maria, Germany, you're a green, so I don't know what we'll get in way of response, but give us your minute if you would.
Ich bin nicht ganz einverstanden. Es stimmt, wir werden in Zukunft vielleicht 10 Milliarden Menschen ernähren müssen. Aber geht es dann nur darum, mehr zu produzieren? Ja, wir brauchen grundlegende Änderungen. Und da geht es aber auch bei uns selber los. Müssen wir morgens den Schinken haben, mittags das Schnitzel und abends das Wurstbrot?
Nein, wir müssen auch unsere Ernährungsgewohnheiten, unsere Essgewohnheiten ändern. Also es geht um unsere Gewohnheiten, es geht aber auch, und da gebe ich ihm recht, um andere Produktionsmethoden, vielleicht auch um mehr. Und Agrarökologie ist eine Form, hier Kapazitäten zu heben. Gehe ich nach Afrika und habe eine Handvoll Boden vor mir, dann merke ich, was hier Potenzial drin ist und was wir tun müssen, um dieses Potenzial zu heben, um diese Kapazität überhaupt erstmal zu nutzen. Und wir müssen das Geld hier in Europa ganz präzise ausgeben. Wir müssen genau hingucken. Agrarindustrie nimmt für sich in Anspruch, dass sie wettbewerbsfähig sind. Bitte dann beweist die Wettbewerbsfähigkeit, geht euren Weg. Aber das Geld, das wir als Europäische Union in die Hand nehmen, das geben wir bitte präzise aus, geben es an die Bäuerinnen und Bauern und gucken, dass wir dort die Kapazitäten heben.
Thank you very much. Danke schön. Cards at the ready. I think I know which way this one is going, Maria. And there you have it. Pretty overwhelming. One or two reds up there, but one down here. Yes, yep. Pretty overwhelmingly green. Ladies and gentlemen, they've been real sports and Democrats, all of them. Give them a round of applause. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed.
Muito obrigado.
Well, now, our time is, as ever, ticking away. It's finished. You are drifting away. This is where, this is, honest to God, politicians. Thank you very much. It's not that they don't enjoy the limelight. No. No, thank you to all of our participants there. So to our final keynote before our farewell presentation. Consider the following quote. Hunger is a cause as well as a consequence of migration. Hunger is a cause as well as a consequence of migration. Something which I think we've explored very well this afternoon. So it gives me great pleasure to spin out this sentence for another couple of 20 seconds or so, whilst the furniture removals come in and do their job, to welcome on stage the assistant director of WFP, the World Food Programme. And she is, of course, you can tell I work in live telly, can't you? Valerie Guarnieri. Valerie, welcome. Very warm welcome. Thank you.
So I hope you're not going to red and green card me on this, no? No? That's for the politicians, not for the practitioners on addressing hunger. So hunger is a cause and consequence of migration. It sounds right to me, intuitively. And as the World Food Program, we've also been doing some work to explore this and to propose some recommendations on how to address hunger and prevent and deal with migration. And I'm going to be drawing on some of that work today. But first, a few statistics for you. We know that there's 815 million chronically hungry people in the world, and this comes out of intensive work done annually led by the Food and Agriculture Organization, which we support. And we know that the majority, what we've learned is that the majority of that chronically food insecure population are in countries that are affected by conflict. So 60% or 500 million people of chronically food, who are chronically food insecure in countries in conflict. We also know that with every 1% increase in hunger, an additional 200 of 10,000 people will flee. And okay, this sounds a little bit, I don't know, maybe not so clear, but think of that if you're looking at a population of 50 million people who see a 1% increase in hunger in that country, we'd be looking at 1 million people fleeing that country. And so highlighting that intricacy, that link between hunger, conflict, and migration. And for each additional year of conflict, 40 of every 10,000 people will flee. So here we're looking at 200,000 people who would flee a country if the conflict persists for an additional year. We also know that in post-conflict countries, with the post-conflict countries that have high levels of food insecurity, are 40% more likely to fall back into conflict than countries with low levels of food insecurity. So we're looking at hunger, we're looking at migration, but we're looking at conflict as the key bridge in this scenario. And the World Food Program did a study last year. It was a study that we did with the Food and Agriculture Organization, with the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, the International Organization of Migration, Save the Children, the World Bank, a bunch of organizations. And it really looked at this linkage between food insecurity and migration. It's the At the Root of Exodus paper. And I'm just going to draw on a few of the key findings to amplify that point that was up there before on hunger as a cause and as a consequence of migration. So statistically, countries with higher food insecurity coupled with armed conflict have the highest level of outward migration, so the highest number of people who flee that country to become refugees. Syria is a case in point where we know that 50% of the population has been forcibly displaced internally or externally. We also know that on average, in the Syria context, a population moves three times inside the country before they cross the border to become refugees. So clearly seeing that link. And then we take South Sudan, a country where I have spent a lot of time recently, and we see 20% of that country's population has been displaced externally, so as refugees. But we also see a country where through the conflict, the levels of food insecurity have been rising extensively. And now we're looking at 7 million people, so more than half the population in the country who are in the state of severe food insecurity. In terms of hunger as a consequence of migration, the act of migration causes food insecurity, and it does it in different ways. When you arrive in a new environment without your network, with limited access to labor markets and jobs, you're leaving everything behind, then clearly one of the first issues that you face is food insecurity. But we also know that the majority of refugees, so 9 out of 10 refugees, are hosted in lower and middle income countries, where already the conditions provide inadequate safety nets for poor populations and vulnerable populations in those countries. So there's very little opportunity for refugees to be benefiting from these services. And then thirdly, and as I saw just last week when I was in Lebanon and in Turkey, refugees often are burdened by very high transport costs that they've had to pay to secure their refuge, often paid to human traffickers. And even years after they've moved, they're still paying off these debts, thousands of dollars they're still owing, on top of trying to meet their day-to-day needs. So in this context, the ability of those people to be addressing and meeting their food needs on their own is minimal or non-existent. So what is an organization like the World Food Program doing to address this hunger, conflict, migration area? Well, first, we're in it. We're in the soup. Because it's happening in areas where we have quite extensive presence. So working in 80 countries around the world, but fundamentally operational at scale in countries that are facing crises, countries that are facing conflicts, countries that are both generating and receiving refugees. And so we clearly need to have a role. And what we do is to use our dual mandate, so our engagement both on humanitarian relief and our engagement on development, on building sustainable food systems, to work with partners who have similar complementary or further mandates in that area to assist vulnerable migrants, to assist the host communities where they work, with urgent assistance in the immediate term, but also in a way that tackles root causes. So we're looking to balance short and long-term work in partnership with government, in partnership with the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, in partnership with the UN Food and Agriculture Organization, and others, in order to meet immediate needs at origin, at transit, and at the final destination point or interim destination points, while helping tackle the drivers and structural factors through resilience building activities, through market support, through support for smallholder farmers to increase their marketability and access to market, and fundamentally to have in place at those different points stable food systems that allow the population, the overall population, to be accessing adequate, affordable food at all times, whether through their own production or through the market systems that are there. So that just brings me to a few recommendations that come out of our work and that come out of the study that we did on the route of Exodus. And 5 points and then one highlight. First is really the importance of taking a two-pronged approach when you're looking at issues of hunger and migration and inevitably that conflict bridge. And that is tackling the political issues to end the hostilities that are driving the movements while continuing urgent assistance to those who are vulnerable because of their movement. So really dovetailing those issues and working on them together is key. Second is really to then look at that third pronged and look at development and really ensure that you're investing across the spectrum in strengthening livelihoods and strengthening food security, both in the origin countries of those who are leaving and in the hosting countries. And really to see refugees as a magnet for investments. They often come to areas of a country that are marginalized, that have been underinvested in, and this becomes an opportunity to create a win-win situation, both for the refugees and for their hosts, by investing in those key areas. Third, and that builds on this, is to support the overburdened hosts. We usually find a situation where infrastructure and services are overwhelmed. And that's the case whether you're looking at a country like Uganda that's hosting the largest refugee caseload in Africa and struggles with infrastructure and services for the population, or if you're looking at a country like Turkey, which is obviously, you know, far ahead on the development spectrum, but still finds its services overwhelmed by the presence of so many refugees and all the countries that are in between. So really supporting and using and building that infrastructure and services so that it addresses the needs of the hosts and the arrivals alike. Fourth is to raise awareness and advocacy among ourselves and the communities that we represent and among others. There is often simplistic assumptions that particular nationalities, if their populations are moving, then these are economic migrants. They're not political refugees. There's also, that situation sometimes isn't reflected in the reality on the ground. The dynamics also change. So you see countries like Libya and Iran, which at one point provided a labor market and benefited from a labor market of migrants coming through and are now serving more as a gateway route to Europe and elsewhere. So the situation changes. We need to understand the complexity of migration and not try to sort of look at these issues in a black and white way. A fifth recommendation is to sponsor further research on why people move. And we found that the start that we made with the Route of Exodus study was key to that. But we have great opportunities now, particularly with information technology, to reach, get information, and communicate with people who are difficult to, who have previously been difficult to access. And we need to understand what causes people to move so that we can address those issues at the source. And then the last highlight point that I wanted to leave with you is that often we think of this as, well, these are problems for governments to solve and that's what needs to be done. But in the with the scale of the challenges and the complexities, this is clearly also an issue where the private sector needs to be actively involved and has both technical expertise and resources as well as funds that it can bring to bear. And it's in that context that I also very much thank Barilla for taking the leadership and the initiative to convene a meeting looking at public-private engagement in addressing food systems and including this issue of conflict and migration and hunger on the agenda. Thank you.
Please. Thank you so much, Valerie. Okay. And yes, I would endorse, as a cynical journalist, I would endorse the work that the BCFN is doing. It's time to say arrivederci to our students. Ciao! Ciao, arrivederci! So we'll let them quietly vacate the hall. What really matters going away from this place is what's actually going to get done. I'm going to return to the words I said at the beginning at the risk of being boring, but it is about action, it is about implementation. Otherwise, what we do in these places, at these gatherings, is a waste of time, and we can't have that. Our final inspiration, then, comes from someone, I think, who is living proof of the old adage that actions speak louder than words. Though having said that, I do, as a teenager, remember his words during Live Aid, or Band-Aid, was it? One of the aids, which were very effective, i.e. coming on the television and shouting, "Give us your fucking money." I noticed there's not a quote for that here today. But I well remember that, and it seemed to me rather a useful advertising slogan, and it served our farewell speaker well then, and ever since, because it didn't stop with the big concerts that he almost single-handedly seemed to manhandle into our television screens and into our wider cultural history. It has gone on from there. So our final presentation is, of course, from Sir Bob Geldof, and it starts with a video. Thank you.
Dawn, and as the sun breaks through the piercing chill of night on the plain outside Coram, it lights up a biblical famine, now in the 20th century. This place, say workers here, is the closest thing to hell on earth.
We were going to do a concert. Now, Bob in his way, this wasn't a consultation with the trustees, this was a statement of fact, this was going to happen. And I think we all were scared.
I actually basically told him to fuck off at first because I just thought he was being ridiculous. We had a press conference at Wembley to announce the whole thing, which was a bit of a farce really, because we actually didn't have anybody confirmed at that point at all.
Come on, people, put your hands together. Celebrate.
concert is being shown on 95% of the televisions on Earth.
We've never been wealthier, we've never been healthier. We know what it costs, we know what to do. Do it. Do it.
No!
You never really forget any conversation with Bob. And once you've got through the various expletives, you know, he makes it pretty clear what he wants.
Everybody knew that neither Make Poverty History nor Band-Aid particularly needed to be in a fundraising exercise again. This was an awareness-raising exercise.
Wonderful idea, except there was about £10 million worth of infrastructure that had to be paid for. And where did that come from?
I simply didn't know how you were supposed to put on five concerts with free tickets with all the expenses that that involves. But nobody else seemed to care.
That millions of you have tuned in is because every 3 seconds in one of the poorest countries in the world, a child dies as a result of extreme poverty. Every 3 seconds. Dead. Everybody around the world, let me see your hands. All over the world.
See this little girl?
She had 10 minutes to live 20 years ago. And because we did a concert last week, she did her agricultural exams in the school she goes to in the northern Ethiopian highlands. She's here tonight, this little girl. Here I am.
Hello. I love that video. It means I only have to talk for 3 minutes and then get the fuck out of here. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and long couple of days for you, so I won't talk long. Those were now, in retrospect, seemingly better times, which is a strange thing to say when 30 million people were about to die, and when on the continent 8 miles north of Africa, the common agricultural policy then as now was ridiculous, but perhaps even more so. We then spent our taxes on growing a disproportionate amount of surplus food, which we didn't need. We then spent even more money on warehousing that food and then further taxes to destroy it, while 8 miles south, millions of people went hungry. It's not quite like that today. Things can get better, but we face different and more perhaps existential problems, not just for 30 million, but for the 9 billion, 11 billion that will soon inhabit this planet. And that just may not be viable or possible, as you've been discussing during this conference. But just before I came out, I was talking to a journalist, and I looked down at my pass thing, my name tag, and I saw the date. And I realized that today, this morning, 74 years ago, the free world invaded tyranny and starvation of Europe and liberated a continent that then put in place the very mechanisms that now we seek to amend. One of the first instances of freedom was to try and put together some form of union of Europe, as Churchill asked for in Geneva in 1946, and which then some idealists and intellectuals managed to cobble together to finally stop the most armed, the richest, and most dangerous continent, Europe, finally get it to live as much as possible with itself and in peace. And today that seems a very fragile pact going forward. But beyond that, it still provides us with a mechanism for dealing with the wider world. Europe still is the richest continent, and still, for the moment, we have a lot to say to the world before it too begins to dismiss us as an irrelevance. Future wars will be fought over diminishing resources. In fact, nearly all wars ultimately are resource wars, just as most of the existential problems that assail us today and always can be at their root nothing more than poverty illustrated. We organize ourselves on a political, economic, and social basis with scant regard and utterly removed from the source we depend upon to make the systems that we need function. There are profound forces that shape the world, and all the systems we humans impose on top of those forces are mere froth to nature's drowning depths. Our system stems from our culture. Our economic and our political systems stem from the culture we've developed. But our culture derives from an abundance of food. Should our resources fail, so too culture, and so too its organized human systems. And that's what we were looking at when we saw those television images in 1984, an entire collapse of the systems that shaped the way we could actually live in this world. Various of the excrescences of this system wash up on our shores daily as a result of war, as a result of poverty, as a result of hunger, etc. And this will continue, but it seems to me to continue exponentially. And it's not as if we haven't rehearsed all this before. we are 45 million centuries old. This planet has been around for 45 million centuries. But this one, our century, is entirely unique. This one is the first time that one species can destroy the entire basis of its own existence and everything else. Scientists called it the Anthropocene Age. Nothing before has ever been like it. And so we grapple at meetings like this with ways to find systems that can cope with it. But unless we take regard for what builds those systems, then we fail, and in failing, we kill the world. Woody Allen, the great filmmaker and comedian, has a typically mordant joke. He says, never before has mankind been at such a crossroads. Down one road is despair and utter futility and hopelessness. And down the other, complete extinction. Let us hope we have the wisdom to choose correctly. I don't know if you understand that in English. Obviously, it doesn't translate that well into other languages. But it does, like everything he says, like all satire, it is only true because it is true. It is only funny because it is true. And when I say we've rehearsed for this moment before, most of you people in this room are familiar with the story of Easter Island and the people who lived there, who built those incredible, complex, and mysterious stone sculptures. Not just one or 10, but hundreds of them. One, what are they? Why did they do it? And what happened to these people? This great culture, this great civilization. And what the anthropologists believe happened was that a Polynesian people found their way to these islands and found them stocked with all the food and water that you could possibly need in dense forests. And over time, various tribes developed, and they believed in a certain type of religion, and they began to make out of the rock of their islands these stone gods facing out to the sea. And status was acquired, and power was acquired by how many stones you could erect, and in what speed, apparently, you did it at. But in order to create these statues, they had to cut down the trees in which all their food existed, the livestock, the birds, the shrubs that they needed. And finally, there was just one tiny, the word in English is copse, small little piece of forest left. And the Easter Islanders clearly knew that when this went, so did all their resources for life. But what do? They cut down the trees. So to Woody Allen's joke, which road do you take, futility or extinction? They chose extinction in order to maintain status and economy and a sense of being and culture and well-being. But they were ridiculous. They were human, and therefore they are ridiculous. The key of equilibrium and balancing use with renewal is the key to understanding the challenges of this world. Nearly 1 billion people remain undernourished, but the goal is to provide sufficient food for all while preserving soil quality, protecting biodiversity, and preserving ecosystems. Not like the Easter Islanders, like other humans rehearsing their little planet. Today, as everyone in this conference knows, we are all Easter Islanders. we've got a little piece of forest left, and we're busily tearing it down. The world faces the great challenge of doubling food production with half as much land, 40% less water and 30% less chemical inputs. And meanwhile, agriculture is responsible for 70% use of blue water, while in turn contributing anything from 10 to 15% of greenhouse gases. Now, do people feel this? Do all our fellow Easter Islanders feel this? No, they don't. Which is why these conferences, though they are your profession, though there are politicians and economists and activists here, feel ultimately frustrated, like, who listens? Does anyone understand? Why isn't policy being made fast, coherently, and logically? It's because people know it, but don't feel it. Our economies, and therefore our politics, have been subsumed by the mantra of progress. Progress, in our part of the world, indeed in most parts of the world now, is defined as growth. But ladies and gentlemen, growth is simply a euphemism for more. More of what? More of everything, all the time? That's not economics. That's greed. We are, as I say, quite ridiculous. Consumption will increase on current rates by 1,200% in 80 years. 1,200% increase in consumption. We're talking about sustainability. We've chosen the B choice of Woody Allen's joke. Except it's not a joke. You've been arguing how to stop this rampant consumerism, the thing that we put the idea of ourself invested in, like those people with their stone monuments that do nothing except express self-esteem, status, power, and the culture. Consumption at 1,200%, you can talk about sustainability all you like. It's not. Sustainability under such an irrational economic logic in a resource-finite world is simply not possible. You can talk about the SDGs till you are blue in the face. America does not care about the SDGs. Doesn't care. Does not care. Doesn't care. So how do we get the SDGs? America and Europe will not alter the common agricultural policy unless the farm bill in America is altered. They will not alter the farm bill. The free trade deals now being struck, eliminating NAFTA, eliminating the Trans-Pacific trade deal. Agriculture is primary with China. They will not alter the farm bill, and probably therefore, no, not probably, definitely, the CAP will not meet the requirements that you wish and that your arguments have maintained for the last couple of days. If our happiness is bound up entirely in our personal circumstances, it is difficult not to ask of life or the world more than it has to offer. We cannot simply consistently go on with the notion of more for ourselves all the time. That is the unsustainable notion. And we can't do it because already at this current population, in the current way of doing agriculture or sustainability, we have already passed the Earth's regenerative capabilities. Now I know I'm preaching to the converted, but the greatest threat you and I have, the greatest threat to our planet, is the belief that someone else will save it. They won't. So the boring job for us is to try and make people hear the dull figures, the endless arguments, the incremental nature of a vast bureaucracy like the European Union. How do we do it? I was asked to sign an op-ed piece for some papers in Europe yesterday. I didn't write it. They wanted to put my name in it. Fine. It's okay. I agree with a lot of it. But the language is dead. The language doesn't somehow articulate the fear or the understanding that you have. Because if it did, one third of the world's food would not go to waste in the fields because the potato was the wrong shape or the sprouts had too many leaves. If that anger, if that fear genuinely articulated, then thousands of children would be standing outside supermarkets demanding that their parents didn't shop there. For all the good of everyone in this room, for all the urgency, for all the necessities, for all the pity of those people crossing the Mediterranean now, for all the abandonment of Italy that has led to an odd government in that country by the rest of the continent, we somehow need to excite people. We somehow have to get them to stop chopping down the trees to build more stone monuments to nothing. And you are all so knowledgeable. You can all talk about your particular answer. But unless it is felt, unless it is somehow shown to be true, then policy does not move. And if policy does not move, then the situation stays the same or gets worse. It is far cheaper to anticipate disaster than to deal with its results. Ladies and gentlemen, you know, it's easy to be cynical and skeptical. And it's very easy for people listening to the things you say to be cynical about what you say. But the truth is, you do not have to believe that tomorrow must be better than today to try and make it so. And why shouldn't we try and make things better if there is some chance of success? And we need more than some chance. You see, your policy guys, your academics, your economists, your, as I say, activists. But it is only when the land becomes a desert, when the health systems of the world begin to strain, when taxes are raised to deal with it, when any food is less available, when water becomes a trickle, when our national shorelines are flooded, when unseasonable and strange storms and droughts occur on a regular basis, then, and only then, will people wake up. Then they will be angry and afraid. Then they will march. But then, well, then it's too late. So, it's depressing. You get a little pinch from some bureaucratic structure and you go, yes, not enough, not enough anymore. There has to be big leaps in this thing. To keep going in the face of all this stuff, I remind myself of a quote from Goethe, the great German poet. Perhaps you know it. He says, whatever you can do or dream you can, begin it. Boldness has genius, magic, and power in it. We have the boldness. We can get the power. What we need, ladies and gentlemen, we need the magic. Thank you.
That's fantastic, Preston. That is that. I swear to God he was smiling as he left the room. I think it's true. There is a lot of truth. We are Easter Islanders. We have a small amount of forest left, of course. We know this. And we are building a lot of pointless monuments. But I don't think for one second that Woody Allen's choice is true at all. I think you can just as easily list a vast catalogue of genuine progress and genuine change that has already been made. And all I'd say is all I'd ask is that when we go away from this place to wherever we go, that we carry on making that change and pushing those dreams. And maybe you get a little bit of Bob's magic, or what Bob would like to have as magic. So I leave you with that thought. And in that regard, we move on. The forum moves on to New York City in September on the 28th, and of course back to Milan as ever in the autumn on November the 27th to the 28th. Big thanks to all of our speakers, everyone who came here to make their presentations today, the panelists, the speakers, all of our technical people, everyone following online, but most of all for you for coming along in person and contributing. I hope you found it useful. I hope you found the way to instill a little bit of that magic when we go away from here, a little bit of optimism, keep the despair in balance. There's much work to be done, but the work can indeed be done. So thanks very much. I'm Alex Thompson. Bon route, au revoir.